الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والفجر وليال عشر. صدق الله العظيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد معد النجود والكرم وآله وبارك وسلم. Can you recite salawat upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم once more? اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق، ناصر الحق بالحق الهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم، وعلى آله وصحبه حق قدره ومقداره العظيم. Just before we begin with the 51st covenant, inshallah, we're hitting the century very soon, inshallah. First of all, I'd like to talk about, very briefly, the blessed days and the blessed nights that we're in, so that we give importance to these blessed nights and do not waste them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the verse which I recited, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, He remembers the oath of the break of dawn, a time when the risk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being disseminated to His servants, wal-fajr. And we did mention to you before, Imam Shahani rahmatullah alayhi, putting much emphasis on the fact that when you pray your fajr namaz, sit for a little while in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is the time when the risk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being disseminated to His servants. The time between Fajr and sunrise, and the time between Asr and Maghrib is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala distributes the spiritual risk for the hearts, for the soul, and He nourishes the soul. So this is why after the Asr Salah you should also engage in a little bit of dhikr, however much you can do, even Salat, Tasbih Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha, Subhanallah 33 times, Alhamdulillah 33 times, Allahu Akbar 34 times, and so forth. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, and the 10 blessed nights. Has Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he narrates that وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, the 10 blessed nights whose remembrance Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in the Quran, and Allah remembers its oath وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ, by the 10 nights. There is a subtle difference here between the translation. Abu Ulama of Ahl Sunnah have said, namely Al-Azhar radiallahu ta'ala anhu and other great scholars, some people say Allah ta'ala ne qasam khai, and there is a difference to say Allah ta'ala ne qasam yaad farmai. The latter is more appropriate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah remembers the oath of these 10 nights. He says these are the 10 nights of Dhul Hijjah, the first 10 nights of Dhul Hijjah, in which the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to keep a fast in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah is equivalent to keeping a year's fast. You will be given a reward for keeping an entire year in fast. And if you spend one of the nights of Dhul Hijjah in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even you pray Salat Tasbih or Turukat Nafal, optional extra Nawafil, or engage in the Tilawat of the Quran, recitation of the Quran, Salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, these nights are equivalent to spending the night of Qadr in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Laylatul Qadr, subhanallah. And especially next Saturday, Yawm Arafah, the day of Arafat, the ninth of Dhul Hijjah, which is next Saturday, it is very emphasized I keep a fast. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about Yawm Ashura, the 10th of Muharram, and this ninth of Dhul Hijjah, anyone who fasts these days, فَحْسِبُوا أَن يُكَفِّرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ. And then the Prophet mentioned the hadith, I have hope with Allah's mercy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His mercy He will forgive all of the sins committed from this year till the following year, inshallah, for the person who keeps a fast on Yawm Arafah and Yawm Ashura, 9th of Dhul Hijjah. So engage in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even add something a little bit extra. If you weren't praying Fajr namaz, wake up for Fajr Salah and recite Surah Yasin every single day. It doesn't take long. There are people who've memorized it, committed it to memory. Whilst you're going to work, you can recite the Quran. Every single step that you take, it will be counted as those steps that were taken in the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not go to waste. Surah Yasin, anyone who recites Surah Yasin in the morning, لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَلْبٌ وَقَلْبُ الْقُرْآنِ يَاسِينَ. Every single thing has a heart, and the heart of the Qur'an is Surah Yasin. And anyone who recites Surah Yasin in the morning, then till the evening, and from the, if you recite in the evening till the morning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of all of your affairs, of all your matters. They will be taken to perfection. You do not need to worry, inshallah. So do something extra in these blessed nights of Dhul Hijjah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give me, first of all, and everyone else, the tawfiq to do this. And something related to what we can do is what Imam Abdullah Habshani rahmatullahi mentions in his 51st covenant. And then I will mention, this is very common here. People ask you, in this day and age especially, every single person, everyone, is in a state of agony, stress, can't find a job, graduated, spent 4 or 5 years in the uni, doing studying, inshallah, hopefully, passing with good grades, with a degree, and still not finding a job. Or an illness that has occurred, or being inflicted with calamities and problems. So here Imam Abdul Wahhab Sha'ani rahmatullah gives us a solution. And he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, أخذ علينا العهد العام من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم أن نصلي صلاة الحاجة إظهارا للفاقة والحاجة كالهدية التي يرسلها الإنسان لمن له عنده حاجة قبل أن يجتمع به. This covenant we have been given, which reaches the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, that we always pray salatul hajah, namazi hajat. Jab bhi aapke saamne koi zurut pade, to namazi hajat padho. Namazi hajat, salatul hajah. This is like, he says, idharun ilfaqati wal hajah, to express that you are in dire need of Allah's mercy, to express that you are a faqir before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَنْتُمُ الْفُقَرَاءُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O people, all of you, regardless of your state of affluence, of wealth or not, every single person in my sight is a faqir before me. You are in dire need of me. Every single breath that we take, we are in dire need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Razaq, Al-Wahhab, the one who gives. And every single treasure of sustenance comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the wasila of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنَّمَا نَقَاسِمُ وَاللَّهُ يُعْطِي. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I am the distributor of the wealth of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one who provides us with this wealth. So therefore, when we pray this namaz, salatul hajah, the namaz of the needy person, or the namaz to fulfill a need of yours, what we are doing, we are expressing our need before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as I said to you before in Salatul Tasbih as well, the more you humble yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more you express yourself before Allah that you are in dire need of Him, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will shower His mercy upon you. And if you don't care, if you think you've got the money and you depend on your wealth, Allah will destroy it. Allah will perish that wealth, will destroy it. It will go from your hands in a split second. Look at what's happened around the world. In Libya, for example, a man whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave an affluence of wealth, gold bricks in his palace, a machine gun that, you know, values more than £1,000 or even more than that, studded with emeralds and diamonds. This was his machine gun of no use. And then he was found in a pit. وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ إِنَّكَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. You give izzah to whoever you wish. You humiliate whoever you wish. بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرِ. All good lies underneath your control, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّكَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. You have power over everything. قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ. He is the possessor of everything. In a split second, a person who is a king, Allah can turn him into a pauper. A person who is a pauper, Allah can turn him into a prince. And this is the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we have the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we rely on the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is when the ni'am, they go out from our hands. They are perished from in front of our eyes. The ni'mah of wealth, the ni'mah of having the rizq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it all goes, because we don't do the shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas Allah says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. When you humiliate yourself before me and thank me, do the shukr, bow your heads, before me in my court, prostrate before me and show to me that you are in dire need of me, then I will even increase the ni'mah that you've already got. لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ لَانْ لِلْتَاكِيدِ وَالنُّونِ لِلْتَاكِيدِ. Yes? I will definitely, surely, certainly give you even more risk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is the shukr that we do? We don't do any shukr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we are sleeping on our beds. Apart from the faraid and the wajibat and the sunan, we don't pray optional nawafil, the mustahabbat. You know, the more namaz you pray, the more dhikr of Allah you do, the more salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam you do, the more you're expressing the fact that, oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if I have the ni'm of all this dunya, I am still in need of you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why Salatul Hajjah has been emphasized here by Imam Sha'ani rahmatullahi alayhi, like a gift that you give to a person before you actually express your need to him. Say for example, there's a very rich man in Bolton. Inshallah. Maybe someone from amongst you. Don't disclose yourself. And then someone has a need. He comes to you. Before that person comes, he brings a garland of flowers, which he buys from Poundland for only a pound. Buy one, get one free, that is, plus. Now he goes to that rich man. Now regardless of that item being so brought with a very cheaply, the man will think, MashaAllah, he's brought something to me. And then he'll give him even more. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah has the greatest example. Whatever gift we give before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is all His. Namaz is His. Rizq of Allah is His. Money is His. Everything that we possess is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what we're doing, we are taking a gift from before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and putting it before Him. And still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give us more. It's like a hadiyah gift. If I have a gift before me here, you take it and then you come back after 5 minutes and you put it back before me, this is a hadiyah from me, I will slap you, for example. That was mine. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is arhamur rahimeen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is akramul karama. Allah subhanahu is kareem, is rahim, is ar-Rahman, the most affectionate, the most merciful, the most generous. When you give a hadiyah before Him, Allah subhanahu accepts it and gives you even more. So this is why He says, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and then before that, actually before Salatul Hajjah, what should you do? Before Salatul Hajjah, when you have a need before someone, you have a need before that rich man, you swore at him, you abused him, you slandered him, you mocked him, you took his wealth from him, you used whatever he gave to disobey him. And then you come before him, can you do this for me, can you do this for me? From the muluk of this dunya, from the kings of this dunya, would you be able to get anything from him? No. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ar-Rahman ar-Rahimeen, let us look at this example that we have in the dunya with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every single day we disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our limbs. We don't do sincere tawbah. We make tawbah and we break them every single day. We make tawbah and the following minute we break that tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to abide by things that He has made halal for us, to stick to those things and to refrain from things and to abstain from things which Allah has made haram, whether it is to do with our soul or our body, whether it's to do with our limbs or to do with things that we eat or drink. And still we do these things. And then we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, I need a job, please give me a job. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I ask you for risk. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I ask you for shifa. This doesn't work. So before you actually do Salatul Hajjah, Imam Shani rahmatullah says, وَسَمِعْتُ سَيِّدِي عَلِيًّا الْخَوَّاسِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهِ يَقُولُ. I heard my sheikh say, يَنْبَغِي فِعْلُ صَلَاتِ التَّسْبِيحِ قَبْلَ صَلَاتِ الْحَاجَةِ. Before you actually pray Salatul Hajjah, pray Salatul Tasbih. Salatul Tasbih, we went through the method of Salatul Tasbih before. لِمَا وُرِدَ مِنْ أَنَّهَا تُكَفِّرُ الذُّنُوبَ كُلَّهَا. Why? Because Salatul Tasbih, it has been mentioned in the hadith, that it forgives all of your sins. It is a namaz which forgives all of your sins. Subhanallah. وَذَلِكَ مِنْ أَكْبَرِ أَسْبَابِ قَضَاءِ الْحَاجَةِ. And the forgiveness of your sins is the greatest means of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilling your needs. And he says, فَإِنَّ تَأْخِيرَ قَضَاءِ الْحَوَائِجِ إِنَّمَا يَكُونُ بِسَبْبِ الذُّنُوبِ فِي الْغَالِبِ. He says, most often than ever, he says, most often it happens that your risk is delayed or your hajah is delayed, your need isn't fulfilled quickly, because of a sin that you committed. So therefore, even before you actually present your need before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask Allah to forgive you for your sins that you have committed. Ask Allah that He pardons you. Ask Allah for His mercy. So that is why it's recommended that you pray Salat Tasbih. If you can, in these 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, if you can every single day inshaAllah, and if not, then especially in Yawm Arafah, 9th of Dhul Hijjah, do pray Salatul Tasbih. These are the days of the Tasbih of Allah, the Tahleel, the Tahmeed, the Takbir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah. All of this is included in Salatul Tasbih, inshaAllah. And then he says, وَسَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ أَيْضًا يَمَّغِي شِدَّةُ الْحُضُورِ فِي أَذْكَارِ السِّجْدَةِ الْأَخِيرَةِ مِنْ صَلَاتِ الْحَاجَةِ الَّتِي يُسَلِّمُ بَعْدَهَا. Imam Ali Khawas Rahmatullah said, when you pray Salatul Hajj, I will tell you the method afterwards. The method in sajda at the end, when you pray the adhkar. He says, at that time you should have shiddatul hudur. Feel the presence that you are in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is this presence? He says, وَعَلَامَةُ الْحُضُورِ. The alama, the sign that you have presence in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَيُّحِسَّ أَنَّ مَفَاصِلَهُ كَادَ تَتَقَطَّعُ وَعَظُمْهُ كَادَ يَذُوبُ مِنْ هَيْبَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. You should feel as though every single joint in your body, every single bone in your body is about to shatter before the awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yadhub, which literally means to melt before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As he says about the state of his Shaykh Ali Khawas rahmatullah, that when he used to pray namaz, it seemed as though he melted before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of his joints and limbs were all humbled before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, physically and spiritually. And this is how we should feel before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As I told you before, the essence is, if you want a need to be fulfilled, you have to express it in that manner. If you want a need and, you know, you're making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you lift your hands and you're thinking about the football match, the score that was on TV, or thinking about something else, Allah won't accept your haja. Allah won't fulfill your need. Express this haja from your limbs and from your soul, from your body, that you are in dire need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to fulfill your need for you, then Allah will do it for you. And then Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she used to say, مِفْتَحُ قَضَاءِ الْحَاجَةِ الْهَدِيَّةُ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهَا. When someone wanted a need to be fulfilled before Hazrat Ummu Mu'mina Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, they used to put a hadiyah before her. A hadiyah, a gift. So he says, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Imam Shani rahmatullahi alayhi, هَذَا فِي حُكْمِ مُعَامَلَةِ الْخَلْقِ مَعَ بَعْضِهِمْ. This is with the creation, you know, some of them with another, some of them who are in need with people who they go to, who will fulfill their need, that you give a gift before them. Then what about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah is indeed, وَاللَّهُ غَنِيٌّ عَنِ الْعَالَمِينَ, but still, give a gift before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Express yourself, humiliate yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, coming on to Salatul Hajjah. As I told you before, the first thing or the most effective thing for your hajjah, your need to be fulfilled, is istighfar. Tawbah and istighfar. If someone continuously says astaghfirullah, does tawbah in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, repents for his sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him an opening for every problem that he faces. As in the hadith of the Prophet that we shall learn later on. So there was a sheikh, Imam Sha'ani rahmatullah, says, كان سيدي علي البحيري رحمه الله لا يسأله أحد الدعاء إلا قال. There was no one who would ask Sheikh Ali al-Buhayri radiallahu ta'ala anhu for dua, only that he would say, قولوا كلكم, everyone amongst you say, أستغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه من كل ذنب. ثم يدعو ويقول يا أولادي كيف يطلب العبد من ربه حاجة وهو قد أغضب ربه بالمعصية وإذا تاب منها ربما أجيب دعاؤه فعلم ذلك وعمل عليه والله يتولى هداك. He says, when that sheikh, someone used to come to him, he was a very great wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People used to come to him and say, Sheikh made dua for me, made a dua for me. And he used to say to the people in his gathering, everyone amongst you say, Astaghfirullah al-Azim al-Ladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-Hayy al-Qayyum wa atubu ilayh, from the depths of your heart, with sincerity, with yaqeen. And he used to say, how can a slave ask from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something when he has angered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he has been a cause of the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by disobeying every single day, by doing things which disobeys Allah, which causes the anger and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he goes to Allah, oh Allah, give me this, give me that, give me this and give me that. Doesn't work. The first thing is astaghfar, is istighfar, seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now some salat that I will tell you inshallah, this is a very effective methods of prayer which have been transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So there are in the wadaif, the greatest and the most effective of all wadaif are those that have been mentioned in the Quran and those that have been transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. So all these wadaif that I'm giving you inshallah, they are all very powerful, effective wadaif. The condition is you have sincerity and you have yaqeen. If you don't have yaqeen, nothing will work. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one narration of the Quran, one narration of the hadith, if you were to recite the Quran, you would move mountains from its place. Mountains would move from its place. But you have to have that yaqeen. You have to have that sincerity from your heart. Hazrat Ubadah ibn Samit radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he was deployed by Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he went to the palace of Hiraql, Hercules, to call him and invite him to Islam. And then he entered the palace from the door of the palace and he said, Allahu Akbar. And the entire palace began to shake. He then sat before Hercules and Hercules said, why have you come here? And they actually told him that we have come because the Khalif, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu, has dispatched us so that we call you towards Islam. And then they pronounced another takbir. When they said another takbir, Allahu Akbar, Hazrat Ubadah bin Samir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the entire floor upon which Hercules was sitting, that began to shake. This was the maqam of the Sahaba that they used to say, Allahu Akbar, and he used to make these effects in their lives. So what about, you know, us? We say Allahu Akbar, we recite the Quran, there's a fly sat on our nose, it doesn't move. Yaqeen, sincerity, tawajjuh upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is one covenant that he mentions later on, he says, that we have been given this covenant from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we never go to a doctor. If we become ill, we use the Quran for shifa, because every single verse of the Quran is shifa. Every single verse of the Quran is a cure for all ailments, zahir and batin. So one hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for ikmal al-haja wa qada'i al-haja. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Warawat Tirmidhi wa qala hadithun hasan wa lafdhu lahu wa ibn majah bi isnadin da'if marfu'an. من كانت له حاجة إلى الله تعالى أو إلى أحد من بني آدم فليتوضأ. Anyone who has a need that he needs to be fulfilled from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly or from his slaves. This means it is not shirk to go to an abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seeking help from him. If this was the case, why would the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam then say حاجة إلى الله أو إلى أحد من بني آدم? If you have a need from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you want that need to be fulfilled from anyone from Bani Adam, sons of Adam, are they Allah or ghayrullah? They are the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلْيَتَوَضَّ, then he should make wudu. وَلْيُحْسِنِ الْوُضُوءِ, and he should do complete wudu. وَلْيُصَلِّ رَكَعَةً, complete wudu means fulfilling the spiritual, the outward and the inward conditions of and etiquettes of wudu. وَلْيُصَلِّ رَكَعَةً, and he should perform two rak'ats. ثُمَّ لَيُثْنِي عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, then he should do the thana of Allah, praise Allah subhanahu, الحمد لله رب العالمين, حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه, الحمد لله قبل كل شيء, والحمد لله بعد كل شيء, والحمد لله كما حمد الأولون والآخرون, and other formulae of hamd. وَلْيُصَلِّ عَنَ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم, and read salawat upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. ثُمَّ لِيَقُلْ, then he should say, لا إله إلا الله الحليم الكريم, سبحان الله رب العرش العظيم, الحمد لله رب العالمين, اللهم إني أسألك موجبات رحمتك وعزائم مغفرتك والغنيمة من كل بر والسلامة من كل إثم, لا تدع لي ذما إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا حاجة هي لك رضا إلا قضيتها يا أرحم الراحمين. You make this dua with sincerity, knowing the translation of this dua, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will fulfill your need for you, inshallah. This is one method. Two rakats, preferably recite Surah Al-Ikhlas three times in each rakat and then pray this dua. And another narration of Imam Al-Tirmidhi and Nasa'i Ibn Majah in the Khuzaymah and Imam Al-Hakim, who all graded as sahih, as authentic, as sound, on the condition of Shaykhain Al-Bukhari wal-Muslim. أَنَّ أَعْمَى أَتَى رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ, a blind man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَقَالَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ, he said, O Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, a famous, the hadith of the blind man. It is called as Hadith Al-A'ma, the hadith of the blind man. أُدْعُوا اللَّهَ تَعَالَى أَنْ يَكْشَفَ لِي عَنْ بَصَرِي, make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Rasulullah, I come to your court, seek your wasila, If he wanted, he could have sat in Masjid Nabawi al-Sharif and asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. He went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because بَخُدَا خُدَاكَ يَهِي هَدَرْنَهِ اَرْ كُوِي مَفَرْمَقَرْ جو وہاں سے ہو یہی آ کے ہو جو یہاں نہیں تو وہاں نہیں. Wherever you want to go seeking refuge, safety, and you want your needs to be fulfilled, you come to the court of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, let's make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restores my eyesight. قَالَ أَوَ أَدْعُكَ Shall I make dua for you? قَالَ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ قَدْ شَقَّ عَلَيَّ ذَهَابُ بَصَرِي It is a burden upon me. It is very hard, difficult for me that I cannot see. So the Prophet said, فَانْطَلِقْ Go, فَتَوَضَّ and make wudu. ثُمَّ صَلِي رَكَعْتَيْن Then perform two rakats namaz. ثُمَّ قُلْ اللَّهُمَّ إِنِّي أَسْأَلُكَ وَأَتَوَجَّهُ إِلَيْكَ بِنَبِيِّكَ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ Ya Muhammad in the hadith, Sadhu Shirah says, Ya Rasulullah, because you cannot call the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with his personal name, with his attributive name. Ya Rasulullah, Ya Habiballah, إِنِّي أَتَوَجَّهُ إِلَى رَبِّي بِكَ أَنْ يَكْشِفَ لِي عَنْ بَصَرِي اللَّهُمَّ شَفِّعُ فِيَّ وَشَفِّعْنِي فِي نَفْسِي Make this dua, make wudu, pray two rakats, and say, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I ask you, and I turn to you, بِنَبِيِّكَ مُحَمَّد صلى الله عليه وسلم. Through the tawassul of your beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Who is teaching this dua tawassul? Who is teaching this? Come on. Who is teaching this? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who came to obliterate shirk. How can the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teach shirk to his companion? And how can this be transmitted to the companions and the tabi'in and the tabi'in and the awliya and the salihin until yawm al-qiyam? It is not shirk. The greatest tawassul and wasila is of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the dua is, I turn to you through the tawassul of your beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet of mercy, Ya Rasulullah. Calling upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the word Ya Nida, Harfun Nida, calling upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whether the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was physically alive on this world, after he departed from this world, and he's Hayyun fi qabrihi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you say Ya Rasulullah, Inni atawajjahu ila Rabbi bika. I have turned to my Lord through your tawassul. Ayyakshif ali an basari. The blind man said that Allah subhanahu restores my eyesight. Allahumma shafi'u fiyya wa shafi'ni fi nafsi. Allah subhanahu accept his intercession on my behalf. And he accepted the dua on my behalf. Hazrat Usman ibn Hunayf radiallahu ta'ala, who was sat witnessing this, he said, فَرَجَعَ وَقَدْ كَشَفَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْ بَصَرِي He returned, Allah subhanahu wa had completely restored his eyesight. Subhanallah. And in another narration he says, فَوَاللَّهِ by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, مَا تَفَرَّقْنَا وَطَالَبِنَا الْحَدِيثُ وَحَتَّى دَخَلَ عَيْنًا رَجُلُ كَأَنَّهُ لَمْ يَكُنْ بِهِ ضَرٌ قَتُّ By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we had just departed. There was only a slight moment's time between that man praying that dua and between us conversating, that man returned as if he didn't have any harm on him before, initially, through the dua of tawassul of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Subhanallah. So make this prayer, make this wadaif. And then a final hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the most powerful after the dua tawassul of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, narrated by Imam al-Hakim, who says, إثنتا عشرة ركعة تصليهن من ليل أو نهار وتتشهد بين كل ركعتين You should pray 12 rakats either in the day or the night, and you should pray tashahud in between each rakat. I قاعدة أولى تشهد pray دور إبراهيمي and دعاء مأثورة in the third rakat دو ثنا pray ثنا فإذا تشهد في آخر صلاتك فأثني على الله عز وجل When you've done the tashahud in the last portion of the namaz فأثني على الله عز وجل Praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وصلي على النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم and then درود upon the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم وقرأ وأنت ساجد and prostrate after namaz prostrate do a sajda and in that sajda recite Surah Al-Fatiha 7 times وقل يا أيها الكافرون 7 مرات سورة الكافرون 7 times وقل لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير 10 مرات say لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له له الملك وله الحمد وهو على كل شيء قدير 10 times and then say اللهم إني أسألك بمعاقد العز من عرشك ومنتهى الرحمة من كتابك واسمك الأعظم وجدك الأعلى وكلماتك التامة then after you made this dua in sajda ask Allah subhanahu for what you want ثم ارفع رأسك then lift your head ثم سلم يمينا وشمالا sorry this sajda was to be the last sajda that you do before you actually do salam this is in namaz before you actually do the salam the last sajda that you do of the 12th rakat then after this ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for your haja then lift your head and then do salam on your right on your left the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said وَلَا تُعَلِّمُوهَا السُّفَهَا do not teach this to the ignorant people فإنهم يدعون بها فيجابون. They will ask for trivial things, things that will harm them, and it will be accepted. This is a very effective dua, very effective method of Salatul Hajj. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to express our Hajj before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the tawassul of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and may He accept our Hajjat. بجاه النبي الكريم عليه الصلاة والتسليم. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا مولانا محمد مع النجود والكرم وآله وبارك وسلم. اللهم فعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا من فضلك علما يقربنا منك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن نفس لا تشبع ومن دعوة لا يستجاب لها. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها فاغفر لها. اللهم لا تدع لنا في مقامنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته ولا هما إلا فرجته ولا دينا إلا قضيته ولا مريضا إلا شفيته ولا طالبا إلا وفقته ولا عسرا إلا يسرته ولا مشتاقا لزيارة حبيبك المصطفى صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم إلا بلغته ورزقته. اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا وتب علينا وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد طب القلوب ودوائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم. سبحان